Welcome to GovInsider Live Indonesia. Today, we are GovInsider with West Java Provincial Government presented this session, Future of Transportation and Infrastructure. And thanks to our partner here at Grab Indonesia for making this happen. My name is Shanti Chitra from GovInsider, and I will be your moderator for today. Joining us over the next hour, we have Bapak Ridwan Kamil, Governor of West Java, Bapak Ahmad Riza Patria, Vice Governor of DKI Jakarta, Insinyur Irman Rashid, Secretary of Directorate General of Land Transportation, Ministry of Transportation, and Bapak Rizky Kramadibrata, President of Grab Indonesia. Thank you for joining us today, Bapak-Bapak. A reminder for all of you that we will be putting your question to the speakers as well. So write them in the Q&A box. Remember, Q&A, not the chat box, for me to see. During the Q&A session, I will pass your questions to our speaker. You can submit your question either in English or in Bahasa Indonesia. Okay, I'm sure that everyone is as excited as I am in welcoming our first speaker, Governor Ridwan Kamil. Mangga, Pak Gubernur. Terima kasih, Kapitan.
Thank you, Ibu Shanti and all the panelists on this GovInsider Live Indonesia in the session of Future of Transportation. Actually, I'm very happy. This is one of the things that I love, which is talking not about COVID, because for the last 3 months, all my agenda was about COVID. Even my dream last week was about COVID. So it's it's too much. So now we'll move to transportation. As you know, West Java is the biggest population in Indonesia, 15 million. And I think transportation related to number of population. The more population you have, the number of services and challenges in infrastructure of transportation need to be addressed. But let me review some of the pattern during COVID. I will share the slide. Coba slide ditampilkan. From our research, it shows that the movement is really a partial lockdown in all activities, except in the residential area. It means you go to camp, if you go to real estate, residential, the movement is still more or less busy. But away from the residential area, there is a reducing capacity of people movement. Next slide. And as you can see, number of public transportations also down. Rail base down to 80%. Public buses down almost 96%. Airlines 92%, and sea transportation down to 62%. So as per today, we are applying our new normal policy or adaptasi kebiasaan baru. Next, there is some problematic issue that we have to deal today is because next slide, we have some issue because there is a growing distrust to the public transport because of the density. Yeah, so people are fighting to move using personal transportations. And for example, in Bogor, the new normal create normal capacity of people commuting to Jakarta, but the KRL, the local railway, inter-province railway, still reducing the capacity to 35%. So it means the remaining of the passenger must find other mode of transportation, which is not very easy. And we are next planning to service most of our 50 million people. So our dream, working with other ministry and also World Bank is to focus on mobility needs, encouraging people to use public transport. And now we are having an increased popularity of bicycling. I think this is good. And hopefully this is just not just temporary, but it's really a way to move around with more safety using bicycle. And we are now starting to change our policy to more to electric-based vehicle and transportations. I think the next 5 to 10 years, we will see government vehicle will change from fossil fuel to electric. Even my own, I'm ordering my own governor car to electric car. Yeah, so we are buying to move to that one. Next.
Ini pakai masih punya akun gua.
And next slide.
Mari enggak tapi ini maksudnya mana tahu. Ini.
And we are building the mass transportations in the 3 metropolitan area now. Number one is Jabodetabek Metropolitan Light Rail Transit. Bandung Metropolitan also railway and LRT. Because in our West Java, we are focusing on 2 area happen to be the most dense, which is Bandung Raya and also Jabodetabek. Yeah, and during COVID, it is also crucial that COVID is a disease for density. So the density created a virus ecosystem. That's why for the last 3 months we are fighting COVID in West Java, mostly in Bodebek and also Bandung Raya. And we are very happy to inform that also our Jakarta-Bandung high-speed railways is moving again. Yeah, and hopefully within the next 2 years we can finish the train and will be the first in Southeast Asia to have a high-speed train connecting Jakarta to Bandung, reducing from 3 hours to only 40 minutes. Next. We are also building many new bus terminals and also creating a series of revitalizing the railway, existing railway. From Jakarta to Garut, Jakarta to Pangandaran, Bandung to Sumedang, and Bandung to Ciwidey. Yeah. If next the map, if you see the map of West Java, you will see the West Java is so big. So we are focusing intercity toll road and intercity railway, and within the metropolitan area we are focusing on the LRT or similar type of transportations. We are having the biggest airport already in operations. We are building new airport in Sukabumi also to serve the south side of West Java, and we are upgrading the Nusawiru airport for tourism in Pangandaran. So in the future, we are hoping the whole West Java will serve by 5 to 8 airports. Also seaport, we are building the most innovative airport at the Patimban by Japanese investment. Will be finished the first stage in 2023 and will create a great opportunities of new economy within the north part of West Java. Next. We are also still in low numbers of toll road. As you can see, we are building the new toll road and the most ambitious one would be connecting from Bandung to Cilacap through Garut, Tasikmalaya, Ciamis, Banjar, Pangandaran, Cilacap, Cigatas, and that would be also serving the south part of West Java. So in the future, people going to Central Java or East Java can have two options, connecting through north part of West Java or south part of West Java. And on the next slide, we are building also the existing railway inherited during the colonial time to be revitalized. It is proven to be very effective. And in the long term, we would like to connect the whole south part of West Java also using this rail base. Last slide. As you know, West Java has a three strength. Number one, manufacturing economy. Number two, agriculture economy. And number three is tourism economy. So post-COVID, the tourism of West Java will be coming recovered first. That's why we are focusing also on the transportation of tourism. So the last 2 years, we donated many touristic bus to all cities in West Java and to create a new level of service to tourists. We are visited by 50 million people a year, mostly locals. So I think because of the local tourism, we can recover the tourism economy faster than international tourism. So I think, Ibu Santi, that will be more or less my opening speech. I think since Indonesia is having a big population, so in my opinion, transportation is proportionally related to number of population. And since West Java is having 50 million, so we have a very challenging task to serve the 50 million. But we would like to emphasize also, as a person of urban design background, I personally like to change the word transportation to mobility, because moving people is not always transporting people by machine kind of means, but also we encourage people to walk, to move around the short distance city distance. We motivate people also to do by cycling, for example. So I think this is the mindset. Not all movement of people can be labeled as by having a transportation. So I think during pandemic also give us a strong reason for us to try new mode of mobility. Not all mechanical or fuel-based movement. So I think that will be all. Thank you, and please continue the discussions. And I would like to have also the conclusions for us. Yeah, as you know, we are winning many awards for our digital village movement. We changed the village economy using 4.0. People now in rural of West Java can feed the fish using mobile phone, can find the sea fish using fish finder apps, can crop using the drones. And I think transportation of rural economy will be coming my new concept for the post-COVID economy. So I'm hoping online transportation like Grab can be part of our vision, changing the economy of West Java in the more equal way. Because as you know, Pancasila, we have the fifth principle called social justice. It means digital, good transportation, not only serving the urban area, but we need to serve the remote area of my people in West Java. So I'm hoping we can continue our cooperation. Terima kasih. Thank you, Ibu Santi. Back to you.
Yeah. Atur nuhun, Pak Gubernur. Thank you. That is a very engaging speech. So let us start our mindset by changing. It's not about transportation. It's about mobility. Okay. Thank you, Bapak. Unfortunately, Pak Ridwan will not be able to join us for panel discussion. But don't worry, Pak Setiaji, Head of ICT Agency of West Java, will be present for the panel discussion later. Thank you very much for making your time during your busy schedule, Pak Gubernur. Okay, we hope to see you again soon in another opportunities, of course. And now, we have recordings of Bapak Ariza Patria, who is regrettably unavailable today, but he is keen in sharing his speech on our innovative province. Let us hear from him now.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat pagi, salam sejahtera bagi kita semua. Saya Ahmad Riza Patria, Wakil Gubernur DKI Jakarta, menyampaikan rasa terima kasih, satu kehormatan bisa hadir sebagai salah satu pembicara dalam rangkaian acara kegiatan Gov Insider Live Indonesia yang diselenggarakan oleh Dinas Koninfo Provinsi Jawa Barat. Yang kami hormati Gubernur Provinsi Jawa Barat, Bapak Ridwan Kamil, sahabat saya, kemudian Bapak Budi Setiadi, Dirjen Hubungan Darat Kementerian Perhubungan Republik Indonesia, juga Bapak Rizky Kamadibrata, Presiden Grab Indonesia, serta Bapak Ibu semua, para peserta webinar Gov Insider Live Indonesia. Sebelumnya, pada kesempatan hari ini, saya menyampaikan mohon maaf tidak dapat bergabung langsung dalam acara Gov Insider Live Indonesia pada hari yang baik ini, karena pada kesempatan hari ini dan jam yang sama, saya ada kegiatan bersama Pak Gubernur dan Kementerian yang tidak bisa ditinggalkan. Mudah-mudahan pada kesempatan lain saya bisa hadir langsung, bahkan bisa bertatap muka dengan Bapak Ibu semua. Bapak Ibu yang berbahagia, saya diminta untuk menyampaikan tentang inovasi dan perkembangan transportasi di DKI Jakarta. DKI Jakarta memprioritaskan pengembangan transportasi, pertama mengembangkan pedestrian. Alhamdulillah sudah dibangun di banyak ruas-ruas jalan. Kemudian kedua, kendaraan ramah lingkungan seperti sepeda dan kendaraan listrik. Kemudian yang ketiga adalah angkutan umum. Kemudian yang keempat, kendaraan pribadi. Dan pencapaian daripada kebijakan baru kami diantaranya adalah kami membentuk yang kami sebut dengan Jaklingko. Adalah satu sistem transportasi angkutan orang terpadu yang terintegrasi satu dengan lainnya untuk memberi kemudahan bagi pengguna jasa angkutan di DKI Jakarta. Pencapaian kebijakan baru ini melalui Jaklingko sebelum COVID-19 dari target kebijakan lainnya, di mana infrastruktur pendukung dan penggunaan angkutan sudah sangat relatif tinggi dan mencapai hasil yang baik. Ada beberapa strategi di antaranya yang kami sebut dengan FUS strategi atau upaya yang mendorong masyarakat menggunakan angkutan umum. Dan alhamdulillah terjadi peningkatan yang luar biasa dan kami mendapatkan penghargaan internasional dari Honorable Mention dari Komite Sustainable Award yang berlangsung di Washington DC, Amerika Serikat. Alhamdulillah kami mendapatkan penghargaan karena capaian yang signifikan, yaitu lebih dari 200% peningkatan penumpang daripada pengguna angkutan umum. Alhamdulillah sejak 2017 sampai hari ini terus terjadi peningkatan yang luar biasa. Kemudian juga kami melaksanakan yang kami sebut dengan full strategi, yaitu melakukan integrasi dalam rangka mempermudah penggunaan angkutan umum. Adapun empat inisiatif Jaklingko yaitu satu, mengintegrasikan layanan, 2 mengintegrasikan sistem pembayaran dan tarif, 3 mengintegrasikan manajemen dan data informasi, dan yang 4 mengintegrasikan fisik. Hadirnya Jakliko di Jakarta yaitu merubah budaya bertransportasi masyarakat DKI Jakarta. 1, shelter yang lebih nyaman, lebih bersih, lebih tertib, dan lebih baik dari yang sebelumnya. Kemudian DKI Jakarta mempunyai mass rapid transit dan light rapid transit. Kita sudah ada, itu mass rapid dari Lebak Bulus sampai dengan Duku Atas. Kemudian sekarang juga sedang dibangun dari Duku Atas sampai Kota Tua di Kota. Kemudian kami juga sudah membangun light rapid transit dari Kelapa Gading sampai dengan Poldrom. Kemudian adanya pembayaran Jakliko yang diharapkan dapat digunakan untuk seluruh angkutan umum di Jakarta. Kemudian yang 4, angkutan umum terutama informasi saat ini sudah memanfaatkan aplikasi digital, dan ke depan seluruh pemesanan tiket angkutan umum menggunakan online. Alhamdulillah minggu lalu sudah ditandatangani bersama terkait integrasi daripada tiket atau kartu penggunaan angkutan umum di Jakarta untuk kereta, untuk LRT, untuk MRT, untuk bus trans, dan lain sebagainya. Dari hasil evaluasi selama COVID-19, volume lalu lintas memang menurun drastis dari pengguna angkutan umum, kurang lebih 80% dari kondisi sebelumnya atau kondisi normal. Pola jam sibuk berubah menjadi lebih panjang dikarenakan adanya pembagian shift masuk kantor. Jadi kami membagi shift jam masuk 2 shift, jam istirahat 2 shift, dan jam kantor menjadi juga 2 shift. Dalam rangka untuk melakukan pembatasan daripada warga Jakarta. Terkait dengan PSBB di Jakarta, Pak Gubernur telah mengeluarkan berbagai regulasi. Ada Pergub 41 tahun 2020 terkait pemberian sanksi, ada sanksi administrasi, sanksi denda, sanksi pidana, dan sanksi sosial. Kemudian juga ada Pergub 47 tahun 2020 tentang surat izin keluar masuk dalam rangka membatasi jumlah orang yang keluar dari Jakarta maupun yang masuk ke Jakarta. Kemudian juga ada Pergub tahun 51 2020 terkait masa transisi PSBB. Kemudian dalam rangka pengendalian transportasi, kami juga telah membatasi kendaraan umum agar tidak lebih dari 50%, bahkan membagi ganjil dan genap. Kemudian pengendalian parkir di luar milik jalan atau off-street. Dan yang kedua, selama masa transisi, semua ruas jalan diutamakan bagi pejalan kaki dan pengguna transportasi sepeda sebagai sarana mobilitas penduduk sehari-hari untuk jarak yang mudah dijangkau, yaitu meliputi peningkatan penggunaan jalur sepeda yang terbangun, dan kemudian penyediaan parkir khusus sepeda di perkantoran dan pusat perbelanjaan ditetapkan sebesar tidak lebih dari 10% dari kapasitas parkir. Setelah COVID-19 dengan adanya penurunan lalu lintas dan penggunaan angkutan umum pemerintah provinsi di Jakarta, Jakarta berinisiatif meningkatkan pelayanan angkutan umum lainnya seperti bike sharing dan alat mobilitas pribadi untuk menuju masyarakat yang sehat, aman, dan produktif. Alhamdulillah, bike sharing sudah kami hadirkan di ruas-ruas jalan protokol di Jakarta. Demikian beberapa poin yang ingin kami sampaikan. Sekali lagi mohon maaf tidak bisa bergabung. Mudah-mudahan di lain kesempatan saya bisa hadir bahkan bertatap muka langsung dengan Bapak Ibu semua. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you for the video, Bapak Vice Governor of Jakarta. Allow me to introduce Pak Susilo Dewanto, Head of Public Transportation Department, Transportation Agency of DKI Jakarta, who will represent DKI Jakarta Governor in our panel discussion later. Welcome, Pak Susilo. Now we are turning to Bapak Imran Rashid, who will sharing about providing a safe and environmentally friendly public transportation. Please, Pak Imran, you can start your speech right now. Thank you.
Thank you very much for Bu Shanti Jitra as a moderator for the our meeting today. I am Imran Rashid, representing the Director General of Land Transport, Ministry of Transportation. Because now Director General, Mr. Budi Setiadi, is on Indonesia Parliament, Komisi 10, discussing hearing about the tourism issue. So now I represented representing the, for the Director General. Then my topic is regarding providing for a safe and environmentally friendly public transportation. As you know, for the big cities, public transport is a must. But we know in Indonesia, still lack in public transportation due to some issue. But we know also, but in Indonesia, the regulation regarding the providing public transport service already very available and strong. As we know, we have a next page, please. Next, please. We have a regulation, law number 22, 2009, concerning physical lalu lintas angkutan jalan, road traffic and transportation. The implementation of the traffic transportation service that explained in there that we have helps to have the public transportation secure, safety, abide by the rules, hassle free and integrated with other methods of transportation. To push national economy, promote public welfare, strengthen national unity and integrity, and be able to uphold the nation's dignity. In details regarding the regulation, we have some minister transportation regulation. We have Peraturan Menteri number 19, 2019 concerning the implementation of public transportation in given roads. And also regulation, Minister of Transportation Regulation number 17, 2019, concerning the implementation of special rent fare for transportation. And also regulation of Minister of Transportation number 9, 2020, concerning the subsidies of urban public passenger transport. Next, the current issue in Indonesia, you should know that due to the lack of public transportation in urban area, we can see here in the picture, so traffic jams, then this influenced by many factors such as high growth in motorized vehicles. So many people travel by using motorcycle, and also due to urbanization, people from village to city living. So many people in the city, so create a problem in transportation, and also the lack of funding for the government of urban transportation. This is good policy of the government. As a result of several problems arising due to public transport, so the worsening air pollution, of course, and also severe congestion, jam traffic, traffic jam, reduced quality of people life, and the high number of accidents. As we know, in Indonesia, around 70 people die every day in the road accident. Next, please. And also some problem based on existing facilities, infrastructure, and programs, bus and line, like that many of buses are poorly maintained, thereby reducing public interest. Not people not interested to use public transport because it's very poorly maintained. Maintenance and also development does development of the facilities and also buses doesn't count occupancy aspect, such as there are many buses that are very full or vice versa. And also difficult to access public transport facilities because we have public transport all also provide from halte to halte that the people need to transfer from door to door, from home to office. But public transport is available until not reach our area, living area. So it's a problem. Difficult. Yeah, and also public transport services have not received overall priorities. And also you have to adhere the punctuality problem in public transport, so it's not reliable. Also, next, please. This is our innovation regarding public transport. We call Buy the Service Scheme, BTS. It is really new for Indonesia services regarding public transportation that introduced by the Ministry of Transport. That service is a program of urban mass transport that carried out by purchasing service to operators by using a minimum standard of service quality license mechanism. So there is the government take the responsibility to providing the service due to high operation cost for public, for public. So the government must to provide some fund to provide the services, but now we call buy the service, so not provide the facility but the services. And also the private sector that participate in the services, we will license, will give the license to provide. So this is new for the operators that have the license as providers. And also there are priority for the government that has advantage over cars and motorcycles. And next, please. This is the business process in this. This is the step how to implement the by the service Indonesia internal job. That the first one, the first step now in 2020, this is the first year, if the government subsidize 100% for the whole services provided by the operators. And also this is that we have a plan and also preparation. We select the city because the fund from the government is limited, so we have to take the priority to select the city that are really ready to participate and also infrastructure in the city and also implementation now already implement regarding the bike services. And the first city is in Palembang, let me see now in the next pages. Next page, please. This is the message process, internal process in Indonesia Transport. The services is provided under the Direktorat Jenderal of Land Transport, called Direktorat Angkutan Jalan, to provide the service and also fund. The payment he provided, the payment proposal from the operator will pay by this office, the whole 100% for the proposal, and also already running in two cities so far. Next. This is the minimum service we call, we say that. The minimum service standard. Minimum service standard set by the government, standard minimum, have excellent both in quality and services. Security in the bus, yeah. There are CCTV, ID card for the driver, and also hazard button for security. And also, every procedure requires safety standard. And also comfort as aspect, for example, indoor temperature, clean and lighting for the in the buses. So before entering the bus, the people have to check the temperature. There is a application there. And also portability and accessibility, where accessibility level is easy to get the buses, but also the fare. Now we provide 100% no free for the passengers so far in the first year. And also we have a quality seat we produce.
We have another minute.
Okay.
You have another minute left.
Okay. And also punctuality, of course, because there is some application to run this program. We know there everything internal of to support on the basis. So the application we can see the number of passenger and also to control the driver and other in the basis. So next, please. Next. Next week program by the service so far. This is now in July. So as we explained before, that program is run from the beginning of this year, January, and finally in January 1st, 2020, the first city that get by the service is Palembang. Is Palembang, South Sumatra, and already launching there. And also in July 4 in Solo, in the second city. And the next other city will be Denpasar, Medan, and Jogja. In so 5 cities will get everything. The cost for the services will be provided by the central government in order to shift the people using a public, private vehicle or motorcycle to the public transport. This is really new for the Indonesian. And also next, please, as you know, but we have here Bandung already study the Bandung in the next in order to get the. This is the last pages, and thank you very much for the time. Terima kasih. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, Pak Imran. So, I'm just voicing I think I'm getting the vibe from our attendees here. I'm just voicing what they are thinking. So, apparently, it's not only South Korea who will have who has BTS, right, Pak? Now Indonesia also have BTS. Let's make our Indonesian BTS be more popular than the Korean BTS then, Bapak. Thank you for the speech, Bapak. And now it is a pleasure for me to introduce our very own Grab partner, Bapak Rizky Kramadibrata. We are going to listen to his speech regarding building digital ecosystem infrastructure for a sustainable future. Silakan, Pak Rizky.
Thank you, Santi. Thank you, everyone. Good morning. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thanks for all the attendees attending this session, as well as the prominent speakers before me, Governor of West Java, Bapak Ridwan Kamil, Vice Governor of DKI Jakarta, Pak Riza Patria, Bapak Sesditjen, Pak Imran Rashid, and other prominent guests that I see in this forum as well. Thank you so much. So my presentations here, short session here, would like to elaborate a little bit how digital ecosystems could help transportation mobility, but beyond that also, there's an aspect of how could we help the economy, especially Indonesian economy, using the sustainable futures. So our current situation right now, as we know it, it's a bit challenging, not only for Indonesia, but also for many countries around the globe at the moment, because the pandemic that is happening right now, I know Pak Ridwan Kamil mentions that he's had quite of it. However, this is a problem that we're still facing at the moment. This is the first time in the modern time that a pandemic like this is happening. And it is changing not only, you know, few countries, as we thought in the beginning, but also changing the way that we behave and we conduct our activities. As we see, the rate of infection is still increasing in Indonesia. So we're facing a new reality where we have to cope with this pandemic virus. But at the same time, we need to ensure that economic activities is still intact. Hence, practice like physical distancing, new normal, should be in place. And the president has given the instructions that people as much as possible to stay at home and to encourage physical distancing for many people, even though they're conducting their daily activities. In light of this, I know that Grab has to cope with this. We are the first one that reacted to this pandemic by giving our first initiative. If you look at the top bottom, contactless delivery, we're the one that first introduced it in March when PSBB was imposed in Indonesia, first with the Jakarta province. What is contactless delivery? That is to ensure that any of our delivering activities could be Grab food deliveries or Grab Express, which delivers documents and goods. It is imposing the protocol of contactless delivery. And what is that? It is ensuring that both our users and our drivers partners are in conducting contactless delivery. They could actually instruct where the driver should put their documents or foods without having any physical contacts. We're also instructing many of our food merchants, because we are the major food delivery providers right now. We have so many preferred merchants in our food chains as well as Grab Kitchens facilities in which we're hosting some of the small and medium enterprise food merchants to abide this protocols by, you know, practicing a minimum requirements for hygienic procedures. But most interestingly that we see is that, because we know that people still need have to do mobility. We know that mobility is reduced, but people are still in need of mobility. So how do we cope with this? How could we still ensure, because right now during this pandemic, people's concerns on safety and hygienic factors are at the highest level compared to before. So we innovated in March what is called Grab Car Protect. We provided many of our cars right now, thousands of them right now is already provided with this, a plastic separations, protecting both the drivers and the passengers. And then we also providing, of course, masks for the drivers and hand sanitizers. And the vehicles needs to be deep cleaned regularly to ensure that it is safe and hygienic. We provide this through a separate service, what is called Grab Car Protect. And then soon after, we extended this to our two wheels Grab Bike, so-called Grab Bike services. So right now, our Grab Bike already have what is called Grab Bike Protect, which carries, every driver carries a plastic separator. It's actually a portable one and could be folded, because sometimes they don't carry passengers, sometimes they carry food deliveries. So it's very easy for them to operate as well. Some of our drivers and some of our passengers even nicknamed this as a Gatot Kaca separator, because drivers would look like our famous Japanese superheroes Gatot Kaca. Since our first inceptions in March 2020, our Grab Protect, both Grab Car Protect and Grab Bike Protect, has served so many passengers, helping their daily activities. Not less than 1.9 million kilometers has been served by Grab Protect. That is actually equal to about 47 times circling the globe. And in an Indonesia context, it's about 350 times from Sabang to Merauke travel. So it's quite significant. We know that it's not only mobility that is very important. We know that economic activity still needs to be served. And one of the aspects is a small and medium enterprise. How could we help, especially during this pandemic, where people spending less time going physically to traditional market, the wet market, so-called. We launched what we call GrabMart during this pandemic period. GrabMart helped small, medium enterprise to be able to still sell their goods, especially for the basic needs and also basic foods to millions of Indonesians. We have, since our first inception of GrabMart, we have helped not less than 32,000 traditional sellers. And we have conducted cooperations with many pasars or wet markets in light of this. One of the beneficiaries to this is that, of course, Ibu Nur Lela Sembiring from Medan, from Pasar Kuala Berkala. Since she joins GrabMart, I mean, like she experienced a reduction since COVID pandemic. But post joining GrabMart, her sales has increased for 40% times on the first day on the onset. Of course, many others we help with this digitalizations of small medium enterprise. We joined forces. We're joining with the government initiated program, what is called Bangga Buatan Indonesia, or Proud with Indonesians product. This was launched in mid-May by the President Jokowi himself from the presidential palace. Grab is one of the six digital ecosystems that launched this and supporting this so far. From the first of the program launch until now, I think it is already close to 100,000 of merchants, small, medium enterprise, joining our digital ecosystem. And why is that very important? Because small, medium enterprise, there are actually about 60 million small, medium enterprise in Indonesia. And that contributes to about 60-something percent of Indonesian's GDP. Unfortunately, only 13% of them has joined digital ecosystem. And it is, especially during this pandemic, very important for small, medium enterprise to be part of digital ecosystems. And by joining this program, definitely we are supporting many of them to join digital ecosystem. And one of them is this small medium enterprise from Bandung, Dorok.co, in which their sales is also multiple since joining our digital ecosystems. Another initiative that we do also is on the telemedicine. Very important as telemedicines, especially during this pandemic as well, because of what? Number one, it is safe for people. If on the first symptom, on any health concerns, they don't go to physical facilities. So they could go to this telemedicine service or Grab Health service, in which is also part of our Grab applications, then reducing the risk for them to be contracted by virus. It is also helping governments and health industry as well, because then people don't go directly to physical medical facilities. That could actually increase the capacities for people that is in more needs, especially on the COVID symptom. Our teleconsultations, Grab Health, is supported by not less than 120 doctors right now at the moment in more than 20 cities. These 120 doctors are working in a dedicated times for Grab, and there's also many others in part-time service, and we are collaborating with not less than 1,000 pharmacies across 12 cities in Indonesia. This telemedicine service, and including Grab Health, is initiative that's also supported by President Jokowi. He mentions that telemedicine method is how to treat patients amid COVID-19 outbreak. It is a great effort to reduce the risk among health professionals as well, but also helping many people. And more than 15 million people right now in Indonesia have been using these applications for telemedicine. Beyond COVID, what should we do? We know that COVID is a challenging one, but we know also that we need to move on. And we need to ensure that any activities, especially that Grab provide the service to our customers, carrying this sustainable aspect. Since the beginning, we are very, very mindful that we need to not only contribute to the economy and providing services, but we need to make sure that the services that we provide will help environment as well. We have launched our initiative just before the COVID, I think early of this year, sometimes in January, 100% electric, 0% pollution mobility solutions. We pioneered the first official electric vehicle ecosystem in Indonesia. In January, we launched what is called GrabCar Electric. This is a fully battery-operated, battery-powered vehicles. We launched it first in Soekarno-Hatta airports, as well as some of the locations in Jakarta. But given the speech from Governor of West Java, Pak Ridwan Kamil, we may also see that West Java then it's a potential area where we could actually expand our electric vehicles initiatives. We are launching also our two-wheels EV vehicles. Definitely, this is something that we would like to push further, especially in a busy and metropolitan cities, to help people to still have mobility, but with environmental concerns that we always supported here. It's not only stopping there in the form of four wheels and two wheels. Our EV initiatives also extend to what it's called personal mobility device. We have launched since last year what it's called Grab Wheels. It's an e-scooter service. It's a connecting like Ses Ditian just mentions, because there's also a needs of a first mile and last mile. And this safe and eco-friendly solution, e-scooter, is also a fully battery powered personal mobility device. This has been launched in many cities, six cities in Indonesia. And we are also glad that the Ministry of Transportation just last week signed and ratified the new regulations for personal mobility device, including e-scooters that actually regulating Grab wheels. That is a very good progress, because then safety and standard operations of e-scooters are well protected by these regulations, and we hope that we could go hand in hand regulations and also our operations to ensure that safety is at the highest level for people that using this. And as you know, with the pandemic COVID, many people right now using many personal mobility device for their activities. I know bicycles is one of them, and e-scooter is there. And soon we will be launching also our bicycle battery operated as well to support more of the sustainability friendly mobility. Last but not least is our plastic reductions initiatives. We know that many people order food through our platform, and it is our responsibility to protect environment. We provide what is called a plastic cutlery request to exclude from the orders. So people could opt in to not, for the merchants, to not including all the plastic cutlery. For example, the plastic spoons, plastic fork. Sometimes we take it for granted that we want those things to be included. And when we have the foods arrive, we don't even use those plastic cutlery. So we have these options, and many people has adopted this, and the adoption is at the stunning level here. And we're so glad that we could go hand in hand with people to help the environment here to reduce the adoptions of unnecessary plastic usage. If we line up all of this plastic cutlery I think it'll be equal until now, it'll be equal to about 15 times of a flight distance from Jakarta to Samarinda. In a Jakarta mindset, it is about 76 times the length of busway roads available in Jakarta. And again, in a more Indonesian context, is it's 190 times length of the Banjarmasin Samarinda toll road. So a lot of us to do, and what we have contributed, it'll not stop here. Definitely, we will still have lots of more activities. Especially, we know that this COVID pandemic will not stop soon. So we believe that together we could co-create the digital ecosystem for sustainable futures. We don't act alone. There's no way Grab could contribute to Indonesia just by itself. We welcome cooperations, co-creations with the people of Indonesia, the public, the government of Indonesia, and many local government in Indonesia. Thank you for listening. My colleague Tirza Munusami will continue for the panelist discussions. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you very much, Fariski. That is a very insightful presentation. Love of innovation and very prompt to the needs of the people. Thank you. I think we need to rephrase Pak Ganda, Fariski. It's no longer apa lo mau gua ada, but apa lo mau Grab ada ya, Pak. Okay.
Cool. Thank you very much. Thank you, Santi.
Yeah, as Fariski mentioned, he has another appointment, but don't worry, our Ibu Tirza R. Munusami, Deputy Head for Public Affairs of Grab, will be attending our panel discussion. So please submit your questions in Q&A box below. Thank you, Fariski, for making time in your busy schedule. Okay, everyone, thank you so much for the questions submitted to us. But before we start, with the question from the audience, I would like to ask Ibu Tirza. So Ibu Tirza, I was about to ask about the innovation in Grab, but there are so many innovation in Grab. But what is the most innovation that you are very excited about?
Yes, first of all, I have to say hello, Pak Imran. And then hello, Pak Setiaji. Yes. Yeah, nice to see you here. The question is, what is the innovation that we are most excited about? I think we're excited about all the innovations we have. But of course, given the current situation, the Grab Protect that Rizky mentioned earlier, the partition between drivers and passengers for both Grab Car and Grab Bike is something that we're particularly excited. Not only because, of course, it guarantees the safety of both passengers and drivers, but it also helps to allow our drivers to still earn income during this difficult time. I think we know that during the PSBB, the social distancing restriction a couple of weeks ago, it hit our drivers as well, right? So we're happy that now they can operate in the new normal. So, of course, this is something that we're happy about. The second one would be the telemedicine that was mentioned as well, because we see that the usage has grown very exponentially, actually, during this pandemic, proving once more that technology can be a solution, especially during the time where physical interaction can actually be dangerous for patients.
Okay.
Thanks.
Thank you so much. I think it's not only Grab that is excited about this innovation. I think Grab partners, which are the driver, would very welcome this innovation because, as you said, they can start working together, earning for their family, especially if they are the breadwinner. So thank you. Thank you very much for having that innovation to help not only Grab driver, but also us as the users. Okay. So Pak Susilo, Pak Susilo, we also listened to Vice Governor's explanation about the innovations in the transport and infrastructure. One of it is using JackLingo. But perhaps you can share more, like how is it going right now about JackLingo? What is the development?
Baik, saat ini kami pekan lalu pemerintah DKI sudah bersama-sama dengan para pemimpin perusahaan BUMN dan BUMD menandatangani kerjasama pembentukan satu wadah Jaklingko, sehingga di sana perusahaan tersebut akan lebih mempercepat mengakselerasi tentang rencana pemaduan Jaklingko. Sebagaimana tadi sudah disampaikan oleh Pak Wagub bahwa Jaklingko ini meliputi 4 hal yang mana itu adalah kendaraannya, layanannya, kemudian di cara pembayarannya maupun fisiknya. Sehingga di situ akan ada satu kenyamanan, kemudahan bagi pengguna angkutan umum di Kota Jakarta saat menggunakan angkutan umum. Sehingga seperti halnya kita memberikan satu slogan, konsumen adalah raja, pengguna adalah raja, gitu. Sehingga semoga hal ini akan membuat semakin tertarik orang untuk menggunakan angkutan umum. Jadi sekitar beberapa pekan sebelumnya adalah sebagaimana ilustrasi fisik adalah bahwa stasiun MRT di stasiun ASEAN sudah bergabung dengan koridor busway 13 di halte CSW. Jadi stasiun ASEAN dan halte CSW secara fisik sudah mulai tergabung secara fisik dan membuat nyaman penggunanya untuk berpindah atau transfer antar moda. Demikian.
Baik, terima kasih Bapak penjelasannya. So we can use we can have a very incorporated transportation infrastructure. So the mobility of the people, they perhaps at first they don't want to use the public transportation because they have to go to such a distance or walk in an uncomfortable way to use one transportation to another public transformation. But with Jaklingko, we have incorporated like the Transjakarta bus station and MRT station, and people can walk in a very comfortable way with a roof and a very pleasant walkway. Thank you, Pak Susilo. Now we have questions from one of our audience. Okay, so it's from Nusnu Graheni. In the new normal, problem related to public transportation is how to control the crowd of queue in station or terminal, particularly in peak hour. Are there any plan or initiative to handle this to maintain physical distancing? I think this question can be both asked to Pak Imran and Pak Susilo, but let's hear from Pak Imran first. Gimana nih Pak cara mengurangi antrian atau ledakan penumpang?
Thank you very much, Bu Santi, moderator dari Bu Nusnu Graheni, ya, luar biasa. How to control the crowd people in station or terminal, particularly in peak hours. Yeah, we have to provide something like a X mark in the facility, crossing mark in the facility on standing lane, on waiting room, for example. And also how we have to educate our people. So security personnel have to be there. And also the kind of rearrange of office hours in Indonesia, in Jakarta especially, is a kind of also how to reduce the number of people crowded. So we have experienced the first time new normal in Bogor, for example, station is very crowded, so the government introduced new regulation regarding the office hour in order to reduce people crowd in the specific time. So we have to at least 3 hours gap from the first group and the next group people to travel. So you have to educate people in the first time. So you have to provide security personnel in the crowded So many people written, and until the distant physical distance, a kind of life cycle, new life cycle.
Yeah. True, Bapak. Thank you. So we are providing the X mark, so in which the people have to stand not on that X mark to maintain the physical distance, and until it becomes the lifestyle, we have security officers to reinforce the new regulation. Thank you. So, Pak Susilo, how about in Jakarta, within DKI Jakarta, if that happened, any innovation or any regulation?
Okay. Jadi untuk kota Jakarta sendiri, karena dia menjadi bagian dari mega cities, yaitu Jabodetabek, maka setiap hari kerja, setiap pagi itu banyak sekali orang yang menuju ke kota Jakarta. Nah, ini dicoba disiasati adalah dengan kereta listrik rel itu sudah banyak membantu, namun akhirnya karena memang kita menerapkan kapasitas COVID dalam artian bahwa harus ada jaga jaraknya, maka membuat kapasitas keretanya menjadi menurun. Sehingga mulailah ada perbantuan-perbantuan bis untuk dari Bodetabek, dari luar kota menuju ke Jakarta. Sedangkan kemudian di Jakarta sendiri kami juga melakukan satu lebih banyak mengoperasikan kendaraan dengan jarak headway kendaraan yang lebih rapat sehingga frekuensinya menjadi lebih tinggi. Itu adalah upaya dengan mencoba memanfaatkan kendaraan atau sarana yang ada saat ini. Tapi itu pun secara hitungan atau perkiraan kami hanya bisa nanti pada akhirnya mentok atau katakan berpadat ria posisi di angka 50%. Hari ini secara normal pengguna angkutan umum masih di angka 25-30%. Kelak akan menuju ke 50%, dan itu adalah saat yang kritis sekali bagi pengguna angkutan umum. Kenapa? Karena angkutan umumnya sudah dianggap full terhadap kapasitas COVID. Gitu. Nah, ini yang seharusnya mari kita dorong bahwa ekonomi harus tetap berjalan, aktivitas masyarakat tetap harus bergerak dan harus dilayani. Maka pilihannya adalah memang shifting jam kerja, jam mulai bekerja menjadi sangat penting. Satu, shifting pemilahan, pemisahan jam mulai bekerja. Berikutnya adalah mendorong pengguna untuk menggunakan angkutan pribadi yang lebih ramah lingkungan, yaitu dengan sepeda, gitu kan. Dan kemudian sekarang itu sudah mulai banyak adalah personal mobility device, atau kalau bahasa Indonesianya alat personal mobility bergerak. Nah, ini kita coba dorong meskipun regulasinya baik Kementerian Perhubungan secara nasional maupun Pemprov DKI Jakarta sedang menyiapkan regulasinya untuk PMD itu, personal mobility devices. Nah, kemudian yang berikutnya adalah mendorong juga orang mau bergerak dengan berjalan kaki untuk jarak-jarak yang dekat. Itu mau tidak mau tetap mendukung satu aktivitas masyarakat supaya ekonominya terus bergerak, kemudian kebutuhan masyarakat bergerak tetap terpenuhi. Demikian Mbak Santi.
Terima kasih Pak Susilo. Jadi kuncinya di situ ya Pak ya, kita atur shift untuk jam kerja biar tidak terjadi lagi peak hour, jadi semuanya rata. Kemudian untuk yang jarak dekat mungkin bisa jalan kaki atau pakai PMD itu ya Pak, seperti yang tadi sudah dicontohkan di slide terakhirnya Pak Rizky ya, yang menggunakan tenaga baterai, atau nanti juga mereka akan meluncurkan sepeda yang tenaga baterai, karena kadang orang malas jalan atau malas ngayuh atau malas ngeboseh gitu ya Pak ya. Baik, terima kasih.